They actually kick in. I run a mic test and I find the first 10 seconds or so, there's nothing on there. So. Okay, Peg, may I have your full name and date of birth, please?
Well, my name is Margaret Cor Lightner. I'm Peg. And I was born on June the 29th, 1924.
Okay. Can you tell us how you came to White Lake and Sylvan Beach?
My mother and father rented a cottage at Sylvan Beach in 1959. And I brought my family, my husband and my two children and my daughter, Betsy, who hadn't been born yet. That was the year that she was born. And we rented Betsy Ross Davis's cottage that year. 2 years after that, we went down the lake and rented a cottage, and in 1962, we bought the cottage next door to what was the old Wabeningo Club from Doris Schweitzer, and that was in 1962.
Okay.
And that's how we came to White Lake.
How did the cores of your family know about White Lake?
They had a very dear friend whose name was Irene Newman, who for many, many years came and stayed at Sylvan Beach with friends and rented cottages, and they very often would come up and spend time with her here. In fact, I came up one time, probably in the late 40s, and visited, and she had at that time rented what was then the Barriger Cottage. And so we stayed in that cottage that summer with Irene and with her daughter, Nancy Newman, Tenega, who was a Jinx director way back when, you know, and that sort of thing. So. And that was even before Nancy was married and way before I was married. But that was my only experience with Sylvan Beach. But Mother and Dad had fallen in love with it way back then. And
really liked it.
And once you get addicted to it, why, that's it.
Yeah, I even live here now.
So. Right.
Can you tell, were you involved, just a question, we're going to jump ahead a bit since you mentioned it. Were you involved in the Jinxes before 62?
No, okay. Never before 62, and it was after we bought the cottage, which is where we are now, and that was the first year that I was involved in the Jinx, and it was Bob Lanier who directed that Jinx, and it was the first Jinx that my children were in.
I'll be darned, I remember that.
And of course, being right next door to the Wob Club was really a bonus for us, because you could hear everything going on all day long, and we're all show business people in the Lightner family. And so it was just like a magnet for us.
Oh yeah, it was very much part of your life.
Yes, it was part. Show business had always been a part of our lives, Tom's and mine certainly up until then. And it was marvelous for us to have that for our children.
Right. We're going to jump ahead here again, but
okay.
Since you mentioned it, Tom and you used to do theater yourself, your husband Tom. Would you tell us something about that? President of Sylvan Beach.
Oh,
Fostoria Glass.
Yes, he was. When he retired from Fostoria, he was vice president in marketing, sales, and
marketing,
advertising. Yeah, he also, Tom was a singer. He was a bass, and in Moundsville, he organized a male chorus and did that. When he was in college, he was in the double quartet at Amherst, that kind of thing, and was always had gorgeous bass voice and was always a singer of songs and one thing and another. And then later years, then he was the president of the hospital at home for 12 years before he died, and was on the board of directors of the West Virginia Independence Hall Foundation. So he was into that very interesting early stuff in West Virginia as well.
What did Tom get his degree in? Excuse me for a second.
If I am not mistaken, he got it in music, and the reason that he did was that he was working on a degree in mathematics, and it got to the point where he didn't want to do that mathematics anymore, so he just thought he'd finish it off in music, which is what he did. But eventually, immediately then after he got out, well then, right after he was in college, he went to the service. That was World War II.
What did he do in the service?
He was in the Army Signal Corps attached to the Navy. He was at Yalta, and then he was in the South Pacific. But he was always on a ship, even though he was in the Army.
But he was like a liaison to the Army?
And yeah, the Signal Corps, the encoding and cryptograph, all that sort of thing is what he did.
Did he see much action?
I think not. I don't remember that he ever said anything about any action, and I think he probably would have over all those years.
What rank did he leave the service at?
Was he a sergeant, I think? He was not an officer. He was a non-com. That's
He'd
all
be
I can
a classic
think.
Sergeant. I could hear Tom's voice. You know?
Yes, very loud voice. He could call those cadences, couldn't he, pretty
I bet
well?
You could.
Yeah.
And the sergeants are what make everything work, so that's a very important job.
Yes.
Very important. Did you two meet in college? Or?
No. I went to the University of Michigan. He went to Amherst. He went back to Cleveland to work after the war. I came to West Virginia. I went to West Virginia to set up a speech correction program in the public schools in the Wheeling, West Virginia area. I went there in the fall of 1947. He went to Moundsville, West Virginia, which is 12 miles from Wheeling, in the spring of 1948. The way that we met was in a little theater production of a show called Two Blind Mice, about two little old ladies who were running a defunct government agency which had been canceled and they didn't know it. And I was the ingenue and he was, an Army or Navy officer. Actually, I didn't like him much because Tom always thought, I don't need to learn these lines, I'll think of something. I'm like George Arliss. You say it the same way every single time, and I want that cue. So there we were, the two of us. Tom was that way about singing, too. If you didn't know the words to a song, you could just sing Watermelon all the time, and nobody would know the difference.
Very casual approach.
Yeah, right, very casual approach, and I used to get so mad at him. And then we started dating,
And then from there on, it
just went.
But, you know, I think that was one of Tom's greatest qualities, was that he had the ability to be casual in situations that
laid back,
pressure.
Laid back.
And I think that's a beautiful, he was a wonderful gift to us all that
mm-hmm. way. Yes. He always wanted peace. Harmony was his thing. You know, don't argue. Yeah. Don't, you know, think of some other way. There must be another way to do it. That was what he always was about.
Yeah, he's sorely missed, and we need more of that type in this world nowadays. Yeah.
Well, we all miss him a lot.
Yeah.
We really do.
Very wonderful man. Mm-hmm. Later on, he became president of Sylvan Beach, right?
And yes, he did.
He was on the board and various... Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he was.
Could you tell us the capacities he had on the board? And,
Let me see. What did he do in particular? Gee, that's kind of hard to say.
Loaded question.
it really is because each president gives to it what he thinks it needs to have, and what he wanted for us to do. There were two or three things. He wanted us to communicate with each other better. His big thing was communicating with people, and it was while Tom was president that Charlie Dupre came to him and suggested doing the Sylvan Tides.
Okay.
And Tom just grabbed it because he thought, whoa, this is what I want. This is communicating. And that was very important to Tom, was communicating with people and for people to be able to communicate with the board. He encouraged them to please bring your comments to the board if you have them, and that kind of thing. He was another, and his other thing was plant trees. He was big on trees. He thought you ought to be planting trees. And after he died, the board of directors planted a tree right next to the post office for him. It's a little dogwood tree. And his children planted a blue spruce in the yard beside the house for him. So we planted two trees. Two trees have been planted on Sylvan Beach for Tom.
And well, I think both of those things, especially with Charlie Dupre having the Sylvan Tides.
Yes.
Will
be last. Yeah, Tom was really pleased with that. And I think that has been a tremendous addition.
Oh, yeah.
A tremendous addition.
Well, it's always fun to look at. It's always waiting.
Well, it is. It's our communication with each other all year long, and it keeps us... I'm always delighted to see it come in the mail, you know. Oh, hot dog, here it is, you know.
We'll see who's been born, and let's go.
You're right. Yes.
That's great. That's great. You mentioned... something earlier, I guess we go to that, is the Wabanango Club fire. The Wabanango Club, that was, can you tell us when that was?
Yes, it was in April of 1979. Strangely enough, my daughter, Betsy Lightner, now Langston, had directed The Jinx in 1978, and as it turned out, it was the last Jinx in the old Wabanango Club. And that fire was in the spring of 1979, April, I don't remember an exact date.
Now, didn't your cottage suffer a great deal of damage?
Yes, the cottage was burned to the ground along with it because it sat right next to the Wob Club. And we'd always said, if it goes, we go. And that was so. It did. The blessed fireman managed to save the garage.
Yeah.
It's still the same little old garage that was always there.
That's true, too.
But not the house. It had to be rebuilt from the bottom up.
And you lost a tremendous amount of history there, too, didn't you?
Yes.
Jinxes and...
Yes. Well, that was interesting because I had been used to leaving my jinx things in the cottage from one year to the next. And that was the first thing I thought of when Dwayne Pearson called. I was on the board at that time, and Dwayne Pearson was president of the board of directors, and he called to tell us about it. And my first thought was, I left all those jinx things up there. Don't you know, about a month later, I looked on the top shelf of my closet and I had brought them home.
Oh my God. Miracles of
miracles. Miracle of miracles. For some reason, I had brought those home. Somebody said to me, take those home this year.
I'll be darned. Speaking of that fire, did they ever figure out what caused that fire? Do you know?
It was either an electrical fire. It was either an electric line or lightning, and I don't know that it was ever, that there was ever any way they could tell.
To figure it out.
It was a storm and a very high wind, a 50-mile-an-hour wind, that east wind that comes off of White Lake. And it was like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and apparently somebody coming in through the channel in a boat saw the fire and called somebody.
Yeah, I think that was Mike Esch, as a matter of fact.
Is that right?
Yeah, I went up to, banged on the caretaker's door, didn't find anybody.
Yes,
Then went up to Jim Harris's house, and from there they called the police or fire department. Uh-huh. I remember Jim Harris, just as a real short aside, just as the intensity of the fire was so great that Mr. Harris told me that as he woke up on the inside of his walls in his cottage, that all you could see was red, the flames were so intense.
Yes. Yes.
We're lucky that a lot more was lost.
Yes, we're lucky about a lot of things. We're lucky that it happened when the season was not in full swing.
Right.
Because there were not a lot of people around. And so far as I know, there was nobody was injured, nobody, you know, and there were no deaths associated with it. And you have to be thankful for the people, at any rate, in that.
Oh, yes. The firemen did a tremendous job. I don't know how they did it. Your history with you can't say the word jinx and not say Lightner. Can you tell us how you got involved in the jinx and what
I'd be delighted to tell you what happened. I sent my children over when the morning came, having signed them up for it. You will sign up for that. Well, they didn't mind. That's fine with them. So I went over when Betsy, who was the little one, was in the little children's act. And Bob Lanier's over there, and he's got, and at that point, he must have had 24 kids in that little kid's age group, you know, had a whole stage full of all of them.
Yeah, that post-Second World War.
Yes, and they were the first ones to practice in the morning. It was like 9 o'clock in the morning. And I went over to watch the practice. Well, as you know, that old Wobbenigo Club didn't have a bathroom.
Okay.
You know. And here were all these little tiny people that had just come from home and been hurried down by mother. And there were about 5 or 6 of them standing there with their legs crossed. And I went up to Bob and I said, if anybody needs to go to the bathroom, you can go over to the Lightners. So I took everybody that needed by the little hand and brought them over to the cottage and took them to the bathroom and took them back over. And the next day when I went over to watch the practice and all the little legs crossed, Bob turned around and said, Mrs. Lightner! And I took the little people next door and took them to the bathroom and took them back. That was my first association with the jinx.
I'll be doing.
And I think then I played a little rehearsal piano here and there, you know, just mostly I just put children in it and helped make costumes and do for them what needed to be done.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, why don't we pause for 1 second and reattach that. Okay, Peg. We were talking about jinxes, and you brought up a very good... Well, just start with your history of jinxes. You were at the Bob Lanier in 62.
Bob Lanier was in 62. And
by the way, his father has a reel-to-reel of that jinx tape.
I know that he has.
Yeah.
I know that he has. They tried, the years later when Betsy Lightner did her Jinx in 78, she wanted to call it That's Entertainment, and I said, you can't, there wasn't That's Entertainment, and it was Bob Lanier. So she asked Bob and Connie if it'd be all right with them if she called it That's Entertainment too, which she did.
That's right, yeah.
If you'll remember that.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, let's proceed along here and see what else we can find here. That was 62.
When did you become the entertainment? Weren't you in charge of...
I was the recreation chairman. That was some later. I don't remember, Joe, exactly the year. But I was doing Jinxes before I was doing that.
Yeah.
Because I don't think there was ever a year when I wasn't really into the Jinx thing.
Oh, that's very true.
it was just kind of one of those things. And we'll see. Well, not 66. It was 67, maybe? Yeah, 67, Happiness Is. That Tom and I directed it first. And I'm going to tell you what was in that, if anything that you might. It's fun to go back over these old programs, which will be available, and I know there are a lot of people that have programs, Joe.
Yeah.
Yeah, if they have not come out of the woodwork yet, there are people who do have lots of these old programs around. And you might put out a call to see if you can get together a complete set. It would be fun to see if you could get a set of those together. And this is one that I really loved doing. That was Up, Up, and Away. And Joe, you did the second half of that. You remember?
Oh my God.
You were Boss Greed.
Greed, was that Boss?
You were Boss Greed, and that was 1967. Huh? No, 1968.
Yeah.
That was 1968. Yeah.
Ward Josephson was Terrington or Harrigan or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was the first Jinx you did, right? That was the first.
The first one that we did was in 67. It was called Happiness Is.
Now, was Jane Goodman was involved?
Jane Goodman was very much involved in it. She was, because when they said they wanted us to direct the first act, Betsy Davis did that one. And you did that with Betsy. You did the second half. We did the musical direction for the first half.
Okay.
And I'm not that good a dancer, and I knew where the dancer was. It was my sister, Jane Goodman. And so I just said, please come along here and do this dancing. So I'm not sure she did very much in 67, but in 68, she danced everybody. Everybody in the show danced, you know. And that, it was a lot of fun because that was the first time they did that Straw Hat and Cane number, which has survived year after year after year. And I'm happy to say now they're doing some different things with that and adding some things to it besides that.
Yes,
you know?
I was going to ask you about that. And it was a Lightner edition.
It was really Jane Goodman who started it. And I picked up on it because she hasn't been able to be here for a good many years. And it's really just kind of something that's fun to do.
Exactly.
And the guys like to do it. It's kind of a fun act for them. It's sort of like the kick line with the girls, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of nice to have an act that they like to do. And then all of a sudden one year the guys will decide, I want to do a Hat and Cane, let's do something different. One year they did that thing, do-wah-diddy-diddy-dum-diddy-do, instead. They threw away the hats and canes and did that instead. And it was wonderful. It was just really great to watch that.
Very good number. And yeah. Tom, your husband made several appearances.
Oh, yeah, he was in.
Can you recall some of those for us?
Yes, I sure can. The first one that he was in was On a Clear Day You Can See Milwaukee.
Oh, no, isn't that was Amy Hunter's?
Let's see. Let's see. No, that was Betsy Davis and Ted Edson.
Okay.
Who did that one? And that was also the first one. Betsy Lightner and Duffy Peterson sang "Nothing Could Be Finer Than to Greet the Carolina in the Morning." And Sally Summer and Tom Lightner sang "Bye Bye Baby."
Yes.
So that.
That
was the first one that Tom was in. And he got into a lot of the others too. He sang Miss America one year and had all the little beauties carrying all those gladiolas around on the stage. And he sang Luck Be a Lady Tonight one year. He sang The Girl from Ipanema one year with a little kick line of girls behind it. The best one, the most outstanding one, and the one that people will remember him from was Sending the Clowns. That was in Betsy's Jinx, and Betsy set that number up and had the girls on one side of the stage in white face and white gloves to do a mime, and he sang Sending the Clowns. And it really was a very effective number.
Oh, it was. Mm-hmm. But you know, the one that my favorite one he did, I mean, that was a superb one. I don't know why. My favorite one that Tom did was Me and My Shadow. Didn't he sing Me?
No, he didn't. No. He didn't sing that. Betsy sang it.
Okay, but wasn't he out there with her?
No, Jane Goodman was. Aunt Jane.
Okay, I'm
Betsy and her Aunt Jane. Betsy was the little one in the front, and she sang it.
Okay.
And then Jane came on with the spot in the back and was the shadow behind her.
Okay, I'm wrong there. I remember.
Uh-huh,
it's funny.
Uh-huh.
So it was Jane and Betsy did that.
Yeah, Jane and Betsy did
that.
Sending
the Clowns would have to be Tom's classic then.
Yeah, that would really be his classic.
Yeah. How many years did Jane work on the Jinx? Help with the Jinx?
Oh, 4 or 5 probably.
4 or 5 mm-hmm. Years, yeah.
Mm-hmm. The years that she was up here with her family.
Yeah.
And then things changed in her life, and she wasn't ever able to come up here much. After that.
How many Jinxes did you work in, you and Tom?
I don't think I can remember that, Joe. Well, we started in 62, and I'll tell you, it's been a rare year that I haven't been involved in it,
yeah.
One way or another.
Oh, that's my memory. You've always been involved,
yes.
You and Tom and everyone.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, everybody in the family enjoyed it, even the year that we did that up and away. And anyone who remembers it will know that we used balloons, and we needed helium balloons, and so my mother decided she would be the angel. Mabel Corr decided she would provide the balloons and the helium tanks, which were pretty expensive for our budget. But at any rate, we just had balloons all over everywhere, and then we had a big net. We had found an old tennis net and suspended it in the Wob Club and filled it with balloons. And at the end of the performance, we dumped it. And the people up in the balcony in the back were very upset with us because they couldn't take pictures because the balloons were in the between them and the stage. So that was when we had to put the photographer on a ladder downstairs, if you'll remember.
I remember that. As a matter of fact, I remember blowing up the balloons.
Out in the back of this cottage back here. Yeah.
Filling them both days, you know, for the Jinx.
Filling them both days.
And
putting that tennis net up.
Yeah,
that
was a rhyme.
Spending part of your time changing your voice with the helium out of the balloons as
well.
Yeah, this is
always fun.
Had to do a little of that.
You know, I've got some slides of that. It was funny because you can see the balloons and net on the top of your frame.
Yeah, right.
Of course, there can never be a best Jinx or a favorite Jinx.
No, I don't think so. Every year, everybody says it's the best Jinx there ever was, and it's always true because each Jinx has its own neat, special things about it, and things that you remember from each year.
That's very true. Mm-hmm. Everyone, as you say, is the best ever.
Yeah, that's right.
What were some of your favorite numbers that you did? The ones that you had fun with, or the ones that you loved?
Oh, I really enjoyed watching the first time that Hat and Cane number when Jane directed it. And she must have had 16 or 18 boys, 8 to 12-year-old boys on the stage. And it was Doug Schaefer and Gage Lightner and Brad Schaefer and Greg Rogers and all, and Jimmy Field and Jim Rice and Bob Mills. Yeah, it was that whole particular bunch of people. And they really looked great. And 8 to 12-year-old boys are not the most graceful things in the whole world altogether. But Aunt Jane was determined that they were going to dance. And they did. And they did it extremely well. They truly did. Oh, it's hard for me to tell you ones that I think were the best. I think the kick line that Jane did when they did Let the Sunshine In, and Chip Forster and Tom Lightner and Chris Netto made those big light boxes, those flashing light boxes that we had on either side of the stage, great big ones, and they got those blinker things, you know, went all over everywhere to get those, and found all these different colored gels and put that together, and then Jane put together this Let the Sunshine In, which was quite different from anything the girls had done. And it was really very effective. It was a kind of a neat number. She did one to Everything's Coming Up Roses that was pretty good too, and the girls had red roses in their top hats. That was well done.
Can you think of any others, any numbers that all through the years that you enjoyed or different things?
I'll tell you one, and Betsy Davis and I both said this, and the reason that we keep thinking about it is we wish we'd been in the age, right age to be in it, and that was one that Gail Griner did in her Jinx, and it was Don't Cry For Me, Wabanengo. And those gorgeous girls in all these gorgeous clothes and bare feet singing Don't Cry For Me, Wabanengo.
I thought that was a Wisner who did that Jinx.
No, I don't think so. I think that was Gail's.
Okay, but that was a wonderful mm-hmm. number.
And then they did a repeat a couple years later, If I Had a Rich Man, instead of If I Were a Rich Man,
yeah.
You know. They did, that same crowd did that in all these, the best looking glitzy clothes they could find to wear, you know. And they looked absolutely wonderful. And Betsy Davis and I were both jealous. We wanted to be in that number.
Oh, it's a great number.
It was, yes.
Especially the Don't Cry mm-hmm. For Me,
Wabanengo. Yeah, I thought that was really quite special. Some of the ones that have been created as the show progresses have been fun to watch, too. There was one that four boys did with Grecian Urns. Which was a lot of fun, and I don't remember. That may have been one of Gail's Jinxes, too. Because it was Toby Roosevelt.
The Goss Boys.
Or was it Toby, or was it, it was a Goss, or
was
two.
Toby and
Anna McCall. You know, some of those kids that were in that.
That was an excellent.
And it was well conceived and well put together, you know. And it was something that was an addition to what the director had put together, which I think is always neat. If you can put extra things like that in it, you know, that make the icing on what's always a nice cake anyway.
Yeah, you're right. Those are some of the best acts or the last minute ones thrown in.
Mm-hmm.
Or some of the best acts. What Broadway musicals influenced you most, do you think?
Well, Annie Rodgers and Hammerstein. Any one of them. Cole Porter. Lerner and Lowe, you know.
And how do you feel about Broadway nowadays? What's happened to it? Why?
I just look for the revivals, because most of the new stuff, to begin with, I haven't been able to go and see most of it. I just this last winter got to see Phantom of the Opera. Now, to me, that's wonderful stuff. I love Cats. You know, some of that Andrew Lloyd Webber's things are all really quite fantastic. I really can't tell you much about the other new things. I know that Tommy Toon has done some wonderful stuff.
Uh-huh.
And I've never been able to get to where I've never been seen any of his work. I've seen him on the television a lot, of course, and I think he's extremely talented, extremely good. But it's kind of fun to see the revivals that they get together.
Yeah.
When they brought back Gypsy, I very much wanted to go and see, who was the one that was in Cagney and Lacey that took that part? And I wanted to go and see her in it so badly. Tyne Daly did it. And I got to see Ethel Merman in that years ago, you see. And that Ethel Merman and Jack Klugman were in it together. And I wanted to see it done by somebody else. I also got to see Carol Channing do Hello, Dolly.
Oh, wow.
You see, some of those things, I got to see Mary Martin do South Pacific and Izzy Opinza. You know, those are some of the things that, this is the reason I look for, you know.
For the revival.
These things are all so great in my mind, you know.
Why do you think America went through a period like that, where we had so much good coming out of Broadway in such a short amount of time? We went after.
Well, of course, Broadway, of course, all of these wonderful show tunes and things started coming when, I think it was Oklahoma, wasn't it?
Oklahoma,
the first one. Yeah, right, was the first one. It was a whole new dimension. It was taking a play that was not necessarily funny.
Yeah.
But putting it to music and putting all kinds of things in it. Good, bad, tragedy, comedy, you know, and that sort of thing, and coming up with that. But and then it just progressed on from that. There have been lots of wonderful things that have come out of rather depressing movies, but books. But then you can lift it with a musical.
Like Carousel was fairly depressing in a way. But mm-hmm. Yeah,
yes, but that's my favorite. That is my favorite musical all time. All time. Yeah. And
there's so much good music in that thing. It's just.
Yes. Yes.
But my favorite is If I Loved You, Time and Again, I Would Try to Say. Mm-hmm. You know, I love that. All those mm-hmm. songs that were excellent. June. When You Walk Through a Storm.
Oh yes, every number in that is just great. I got a very, this hasn't got anything to do with Sylvan Beach, but I had seen Carousel, Tom and I had seen Carousel in New York one time or another, and then it was going to come to Wheeling, the truck and bus was going to come to Wheeling, and it's a big theater, and good stuff comes there. I've seen an awful lot of stuff there I wouldn't have seen if it weren't there. I took all three of my children and Gage's girlfriend at the time to see it. And we got in the theater, and it's the winter time, and we sat, and pretty soon, John Raitt, it was his company, came out and said to us, folks, we are here. This is a theater with 2,300 people in it, every seat full. We are here. Our trucks have not come in. We have nothing. We have one score. We have been able, thanks to CA House, the music company locally, to get some instruments together. The only instruments they had were the ones that people had carried in their hands. That, you know, they didn't have any of their big, no drums, no, you know, none of those things that you need. So they'd gotten together what they could. And he said, we are going to go ahead and give you a show tonight, but it will be done in modern dress and without props and without scenery. If you would like to have your money back, please go to the box office because we understand how you feel. Not one soul left that theater. That was some performance.
Oh, okay.
It was every bit as good as if they'd had costumes and props and everything else. And at the end where they have that star and they tell him where to hang the star, he handed it up to him and says, hang this star over Wheeling, West Virginia with all my love. You know,
wow.
At the end of the show, he brought the entire cast out on the stage and they sang every song from every show they'd ever been in. They just sang.
What a wonderful.
And he came back the next year with Pajama Gabe.
Oh,
and we did, and of course that show just went on as planned, but he still brought them all out in front and sang for us at the end. He said that it was because of Wheeling, West Virginia that he got on the front cover of Variety. Because of that performance that they gave.
Oh, that must have been a spectacular experience.
It was an interest. It was a very interesting experience. And my kids were just, it was a good lesson for them in how you can go ahead and do it.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be a set way.
Radio,
you can manage.
Why can't this?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Use your imagination. You know?
That's right. Uh-huh.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So it was really fun. Really fun.
That's an incredible story. just as an aside, we have, of course, Betsy Ross Davis was in Oklahoma. And
yes,
Carousel,
she was. And Carousel.
With
yes.
John Raitt.
Yes, indeed.
And,
so.
Certainly very favorable. But I've heard also she was in Oklahoma with Joel Grey was in it at that time.
Is that right?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Mr. Schmidt was telling me that, that they had an experience when the show toured. Uh-huh. So that's. Did you ever get to you and Tom every summer as long as I can remember? You've been into Broadway. You never missed anything on Broadway that was worth anything. Did you ever get to know any of the stars or people or have any experiences?
No.
Mm-mm. Just that one.
No.
With John Raitt's cast.
Yeah, that's about as close.
Incredible.
Yeah. I can't think. One time we went to have dinner at Sardi's after the. After we'd been to see, oh, I know, we were going to see Where's Charlie? Ray Bolger's Where's Charlie? And we were having dinner at Sardi's first, and I heard somebody laugh behind me, and I thought, Ray Bolger! And I turned around, and it was. And the gal that was with me kept saying, Peg, will you turn around and eat your dinner? We have to go to the theater, because I kept looking at him. You know, I'm sure he didn't care.
No,
he's used to being looked at.
Yes.
But we're paying a fortune to eat in Sardi's. You might as well eat your dinner, you know. Now, I guess that may be as close as I ever got to really meeting any of them.
So you would rank probably Carousel as your favorite?
Yes, Carousel.
And then after Carousel, what would you, how would you go down the list there?
Well, I'll tell you another one that, when the end of that thing came, I wanted to stay and see it again. And that was Kismet. And that was Alfred Drake, and Alfred Drake was something else.
Yeah.
He was in Kiss Me, Kate, and he was in Oklahoma. And then he was in Kiss Me, Kate, and he was in Kismet.
Some and awful good tunes from Kismet.
Oh, yeah. I don't know that any of them take my hand. I'm a stranger in paradise. Yes.
Stranger.
Baubles, bangles, and beads.
Well, that was from your church.
Yeah.
Oh, that was like a Stan Freeberg tune, you know. Baubles, bangles, bright. That's fair. What would you rank third or fourth?
Oh, let me see. Oh, that's so hard. I saw 1,000 years ago with B. Lilly in it.
Oh, my God.
B. Lilly. And Jack Haley called Inside USA. And there was a little number in that I thought was just dialing. It's called Little Old Rhode Island Was Famous for You. And it was like, pencils come from Pennsylvania, vests from West Virginia. But why should you be blue? They know mink where they grow mink in Wyoming. A camp chair in New Hampshire, that's for me. You know, it was just, that was a neat song. One neat song, Jack Haley sang that. Beatrice Lilly, who was the neatest clown in the world. Absolutely great. I would love to have been Beatrice Lilly. I could have seen myself being Beatrice Lilly. But she directed a little opus called Come, Oh Come to Pittsburgh with full chorus, everybody, and with her back to the audience, doing all sorts of weird things with her body and scratching her legs and scratching her behind, you know. It's just funny little things that turn up in your head.
Uh-huh.
A lot of things that a lot of people don't even remember or maybe didn't even see. Turn her off.
Take a pause. Well, we had to take a little break there to spray for spiders.
That's right.
So,
says he's done almost everybody on the beach except mine and the lady next door, so.
Always, that stuff smells, I'll tell you. We're on Broadway plays and that. We're talking about different shows, your favorite shows. Do you have any more that you can remember that you saw that were outstanding performances?
Guys and Dolls.
Guys and Dolls. Now, who was in that when you saw that?
Robert Alda, Vivian Blaine. I can't think. I mix it up with the movie now, you know, because it's been a long time since I've seen that Guys and Dolls. But that was the original Guys and Dolls. That wasn't the. It wasn't this recent one. It was. Way back when I used to sneak in and go with Tom to New York when he went on business, and then I'd just go see shows when you know, the whole time that I was there. And those were back in the days when you could afford to go to three or four shows when you went to New York.
Yeah. Yeah.
cheaper and different.
Right, yeah. Right.
Yeah. Again, what do you have any idea about why we aren't producing the Broadway plays we did at one time, the amount of great ones? You know, we seem to have gone through a heyday there for 15, 20 years, the end of the second.
Oh, I think it'll happen again. Yeah.
It's like more things will come around again.
Yes. You just have to wait for the combination of people to come along to do them. It seemed like Lloyd Webber came along and did a number of very nice ones. And then a good many people, done maybe one or two. And then there are names that you don't remember because you don't hear them again and again, which is kind of too bad, because they may have been something that was just as good as others that you've seen.
That's true. If there's not that staying power type of thing, then you might not remember as much. Mm-hmm. So you really don't have any social interpretation of what may have happened?
No, I really don't. Who knows?
Who knows, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It isn't as if there weren't audiences there for them.
Yeah.
And there still are those.
Yeah.
Even in a little place like Wheeling, West Virginia, because when they offered us a little package, which was Singing in the Rain and Cats one year, our local television station got together this little package of truck and bus for us. And of course, we all immediately sent for the two of them. They sold out Cats so fast that they asked them if they could give them another night, and they said no, the cast of Cats, they couldn't do it, but if you'd wait, change the date to the end of the tour, we'll come for three nights, which they did, and they filled that 2300 seat thing three nights in a row. So even in an area like that, it just, people are crying for the good stuff.
People,
you know,
love it. Yeah,
yeah,
you know, you just
lots of people are,
yeah.
Lots of people are.
And I think if anybody ever catches on to bring it back in any strength,
see, that's,
it'll be very successful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. People are starving for their greatness.
Mm-hmm.
Go on.
No, that's it. I just wonder, I keep hoping that some of these good revivals will encourage some younger people to create some stuff of their own, you know, because they're reviving these things because there isn't anything else. They haven't got enough new stuff to...
Yeah.
And yet, you don't want all these wonderful old things to die out. You need to see them again now and again,
right.
And they need to be done. And of course, so many of them are done now by community theaters and that kind of thing, and those are fun to see, too. Those are fun to see. It's fun to see the locals do them. It really is. And they turn in some wonderful performances.
Oh,
just wonderful performances.
There's great people out there that never go on stage. It could be just as good as any of them, I think. Yeah.
I'll tell you one that I've seen, and I've seen it in New York about four times, and that was the Fantastics.
Oh, God.
And I think that's an unforgettable experience. I think everybody ought sometime or other to get to see that.
Oh, I agree. When Cynthia Neely sang, try to...
Yes, I remember that. That was my first introduction to that.
Well, same here. That was the first thing I ever knew about Fantastics. And what a wonderful little act that was. What a great act that was.
Uh-huh.
What a loss she was.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. I remember.
So
I remember her with a lot
so
of love and affection.
Yeah, it's true.
A very talented little gal.
Speaking of, we're talking about Broadway and about maybe the stuff that we used to turn out isn't being turned out and things like that. Is there a reflection of that? Do you see in Jinxes as the time has gone on? For instance, you can remember when we had the Bob Lanier's and the Stevie McClave sets.
Uh-huh.
And, we had Doug Schmitz, we had a lot of those things, and now we don't seem to have the sets or people painting or doing things that they used to do. Do you have any idea why that is? Not that it's bad or good or anything.
I think probably a lot of that is that our younger people are not spending as much time in the summers at White Lake as they were able to do.
Yeah.
In those years when you came up with your family at the beginning of the summer, you stayed all summer.
And school didn't begin until
after Labor Day, you know, and it was Memorial Day to Labor Day, or 4th of July to Labor Day, or whatever. And the world has just changed. It's different, and I know that it's frustrating for, well, people your age. And see, you talked about Doug Schmidt, who did those things. Well, he's still doing it.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, he's still into it big time, you know. That kind of thing. Buffy Tukey's another one who had a lot of talent.
Yeah.
along those lines.
She did.
And there have been others, lots of others, who've created stuff along those lines. Buffy is a graphic artist and went to the Art Institute in Chicago. You see, she's still doing that kind of thing. And that sort of person is still going to come along, but you don't see them up here so often when they're young, because they don't get to spend their whole summers up here.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, we were very privileged to live in that golden Second World War age.
That's right. That's right. And it'll never come back.
No.
But they are years to remember and to treasure.
Oh, I don't think, you know, I often...
To treasure.
Yeah, exactly. They're mm-hmm. the most special times in history, almost, mm-hmm. to have been alive during that period, mm-hmm. the post-Second World War.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And the affluency of this country and what it did for a few.
Yes.
Was very great. Buffy Tukey was another one you mentioned. Can you think of others? Helen Rice was...
Oh, Helen Rice, yes. She was a very talented... I hate to call out names, because you can't call out all of the talented people. And people who just turned up out of nowhere and turned out to be so useful and helpful. Susie Carnwath.
Oh, exactly, Susie Carnwath.
And bless her heart, she came over there and just great with the dancers. And the singers. She taught those little gals that were doing the kick line how to change their voice from one octave to the next one. She gave them a singing lesson one day so that they could do it without belting, you know, that sort of thing. Just little things like that. And she just, it was great to have her here.
Oh, she was incredible.
Just
she
great.
She just walked in the door one day and that was it. It was like,
can I help? And this is what happens. And there are still people like that around.
Yeah.
The thing that's happened with the Jinx is because people are not here all summer long, it makes it a little harder for the director, because the director has to kind of stand still until it gets close to time, because then people get their time off and they come up here and then they go to the director and say, can I help?
Yeah.
And that's hard for a director to do, is to be able to hold still and know it is going to come together.
Yeah.
Somebody will pull the curtain. Somebody will work the lights. You know, there will be somebody there to do those things.
Yeah.
And it always works out that way.
Yeah. Well, you're right.
It always comes off, and it's always great.
It's that loss of control that scares everybody.
I think that's it. That's it. You think to yourself, what's happening here? I don't know what's going on here. Why don't I know what's going on here? You know? And you think to yourself, I'm not in control here. What's, you know? But if you can just hang on to yourself with it,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Can you remember anything that, things that happened during Jinxes that weren't planned, accidents or mistakes or...
Well, I'll tell you one thing we had with that old Wob Club was that curtain. And the curtain just, we'd get it fixed. We'd get the people out here and we'd get the curtain fixed and we'd get the track fixed. And it would work fine up until the time for the performance, and then one of the curtains wouldn't come open. And so you'd have to stand there, and somebody would have to stand there and hold the curtain open for every act.
Oh, yeah, and then it gets stuck.
Finally, one year we just said, all right, the money this year is going to a new track. And we took down the old track. I had the stage full of people taking out hooks, repairing tears, sewing new hooks into the curtain until we got it all right, and they took down the old track, put a new track up, and we put the curtain up. By George, we had a curtain that opened both sides every night. And I don't even... Oh, that's been a long time ago, though.
That curtain was... I remember one classic incident when Mimi Gillen, mm-hmm. during the kick line, lost her... skirt, and then they tried to get the curtain closed, and the curtain wouldn't close halfway through it. There was always something.
Yes, there were
those little incidents.
Right.
Do you remember anything else that happened during the Jinxes that weren't exactly planned but occurred, or any?
Oh, well, they do. You know, something always does.
How about the lighting? Yeah, I mean, those footlights were always, to me, dangerous at best.
Oh, yes, they truly were. That was one of the things. When there was a point at which we put the lights up behind the stage, was that after we built the new clubhouse? I guess it was.
Yeah.
That we did not put any lights on the stage, simply because of that many children and the kind of things you wanted to do, like steam heat, where you were blowing heat around, and people using water pistols for this or that, or you know, making temporary messes on the stage and that sort of thing. And those old lights on that old Wob Club stage were pretty iffy at best, you know. That stage was very high off of the floor anyway, you know, and it was...
Well, I can remember being on stage with water and things being thrown around. I can remember a couple times watching smoke rise from out of the footlights.
Yes, yes.
Just waiting.
That was always a worry. To me, it was, when I was doing it, was a worry for the little children, was those footlights and keeping them away from the footlights.
Yeah, very good point, because those were dangerous at best. Mm-hmm. Do you, what back when you started doing these jinxes, were involved in them, now we have a very wonderful stage and everything, a lot of fancy stuff, and we have a telephone between upstairs and the lighting and downstairs.
Yeah.
What did you used to do for the lighting to communicate from backstage up to the lighting?
It seems to me we had one of those walkie-talkies. You know, there was some kind of communication there with the spotlights. And then occasionally you just say to them, in this number you do this, and in this number you do that, and be on, you know, you're on your own.
Yeah.
You're up there and I'm down here, and never the twain shall meet, so do it.
And then there's the people that every once in a while somebody would just lean their head out from backstage and look up there.
Yeah, right. Yes, there's that too.
On the old things that happened with the Jinx, who was in the speaker? We certainly have to cover who played for the Jinx those years that you were involved.
The years that I was involved with it. Well, Carol Krause, now Carol Burnett, played piano for many, many years and is still to this day a very, very good friend of mine. And of course, Mary Lynn Andreessen has gone and borrowed a bass fiddle and been there every year for us.
For how many years?
I can't tell you, but you see, she did it when her father, Harold Mulder, was playing piano and doing the Jinxes. So I suppose all of her life she's been doing that. And she enjoys that. She plans to be here to do that because she likes doing it.
Yeah.
And then we've had, for a long time we had Earl Launouette on the drums.
A fine man.
Absolutely the greatest. Betsy Lightner called him Earl Baby. She just thought he was the greatest thing in the world. Yes, and his wife was Lorna Baby. They were just, he was just something else.
He was just very kind.
He was a wonderful man. Wonderful man. And a terrific drummer.
Yeah.
Yes.
He loved those drums.
Yes, he surely did. And then after that, we've had various and sundry other drummers. Sonny Pops played the drums, and Scott Johnson played the drums.
And Joe Carnwith.
And Joe Carnwith played the drums, and Sean Manny played the drums. You know, over the years, somebody has turned up to do it. There have been now a number of different pianists in the last years, too. And I don't really remember most of the names of those pianists. But they're, again, all just fine, you know. You get on the property and go after it. And somehow, Bob Drew's another one that's played a lot of piano.
That's right. Bob.
He's now on the board of directors, so he's still with us. And he enjoys it, too.
Very good man.
He's just super. Just super.
As a matter of fact, you can't think of very many that are around here.
That's right. That's right.
It's a wonderful situation.
Mm-hmm.
Very kind. Do you remember dress rehearsals that were particularly bad?
Every one of them was bad. I never knew a good dress rehearsal. But then we always said that's a sign of a good show. I think if I'd had a good dress rehearsal, I'd have thought, wait a minute. What's it going to be like tomorrow night, you know?
Yeah, we're clicking too well.
But when you have a bad dress rehearsal, there's nowhere to go but up. So, you know.
That's right.
And I think it kind of scares everybody. Oh, I can't be that bad tomorrow night. I got to be better than that, you know.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, he's up the gas.
Yes, right.
Speaking of that, did you ever figure out a momentum to the Jinx? For instance, if it was really good Friday night, when Saturday night everybody's kind of off because it was so good, or vice versa. Could you ever put any rhyme or reason to the whole spectacle in any way like that?
No. A lot of people I know would buy tickets and go one of the two nights. I always bought enough tickets so I could go both nights, you know, because I always wanted to see, you know, if something's going to be different. And over the years, people will, some of these, the older kids that are still Jinx babies are turn up at the end of the week and can't get the act together for Friday night, but they can get it together on Saturday. And then if the director will let them, they get to do it on Saturday night. And so if you don't go Saturday night, you it's a different show from Friday night,
right?
Sometimes.
And many times skits are thrown in there that you only do.
Besides that, the acts are never the same two nights in a row.
That's right.
You know?
Well, they rehearse for 13 days.
You're right. You should expect perfection, I suppose, huh? Well, that wouldn't be any fun.
Okay, what fun, speaking of fun, what was the most fun Jinx you ever worked with? I mean, just was fun.
I really think that Up, Up, and Away.
Oh, it was.
I don't know what it was. It was just the combination of everything that just went together just that particular time.
That's always been probably my favorite.
Yeah.
I think of it
because it was the easiest one. You know, it kind of fell together. All the numbers kind of fell together.
Yes.
And if I remember correctly, that was the year that my sister and I kept calling each other up back and forth across the country and suggesting numbers. So that by the time we got up here, we had all the numbers and we had reworded everything we were going to. We had all of it done ahead of time.
That's right.
So, and I don't know, that's another thing that you could do then. You could do that.
Yeah.
You you have to wait now until you see how many people you have for different things. In those days, you had so many people that you had to split groups in order to get them all on the stage. The first kick line that I ever saw, which was the one that Bob Lanier did, which was,
yes,
"Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend." I don't know that I've seen a better one since. Now, all the girls are wonderful, but that was a double kick line. There were so many of them. It was two lines on the stage.
That was our age group, Dee Josephson, and Martha,
yes,
Bradley,
it was.
All those people.
Yeah, Mickey Murphy, Betsy Bogart, you know, that whole crowd.
Yeah.
And it was elegant, and I know that he rehearsed them a lot, because my bedroom was on this side of the cottage, which was where the Wob Club was. And at 5 o'clock, I'm getting dressed for dinner, and at 5 o'clock in the Wob Club, he's rehearsing "A Kiss on the Hand, Maybe," every day for 3 weeks. Now, he rehearsed them for 3 weeks, so it's something you can't do anymore either. It has to be two, because you don't have the time. But every day for 3 weeks at 5 o'clock, this is what I heard. And I kept thinking, I ought to go see what he's doing. And then I thought, no, let it be a surprise for you. You know, and I was very surprised and delighted with it when I saw it. Because that was as close to a perfect number as you're going to get.
Yeah. That's funny you mentioned that one, because that's the one I always remembered as my,
yes,
favorite.
Mm-hmm.
Was that one? Well, we mentioned the name, and Bob Lanier did that Jinx, and Bob is not here now. He's,
mm-hmm,
just passed away, and
mm-hmm,
he was a very wonderful fellow that had a, mm-hmm, great deal of talent.
He certainly did.
He was sorely missed by us all.
That's right.
Put on one of the greatest Jinxes, I think.
It was a very, very fine Jinx.
Jinx.
My children all enjoyed that one, and I remember all the numbers that they were in.
Yes.
Betsy was in Happy Talk.
Yes.
And my other two were in I Whistle a Happy Tune.
Yeah, Happy Talk.
You're right. There were, you know, I remember all the numbers from that one.
Yeah.
Had some skits in it that were funny, too.
Yeah. Yes, those were, it was fun. It was fun. But as you say, with the time change in schools and the,
mm-hmm,
little lack of kids there for a while, things, mm-hmm, just kind of slowed down. What at White Lake, getting to the Jinx also, but a little expanding,
yeah,
what are some of the most notable characters that you remember from White Lake during your period here?
Notable characters.
Somebody famous that you saw here, or somebody that just was a character, Mr. Schmidt, or so, you know, just somebody that, people that you remember here. Of course, your husband, Tom, was probably one of the greatest characters.
Oh, yes, right. Yes, well, we'll start with him. John Reitz. Do you know this name? Played the trumpet.
He used to play it at the,
yes,
lake.
Yes, yeah. He played on the lake, and we were privileged to meet him. He was staying over at Ina Diamond's one night. Oh, this is a long time ago again. But he was over there, and we had not met, and Ina said, come over and meet John, and she was telling us that this is what he did. Tom looked at him and says, "You want to play tonight?" And John said, "Well, sure." So we brought him over and put him in the big green boat, took him out in the lake, and he did a little concert that night. And that was kind of fun. And everybody that heard him, of course, that knew him, recognized it and remembered, there's John out there with his trumpet again. That was fun.
Well, that was
fun, too. That is, hey, Joe, I don't know about characters. This place is full of characters up here.
Well, that's one of the things I want to know when you ask that around here. You can go down the road.
So where do you want me to start? Which house? Shall I start at this end or this end, you know? We have in there lots of very interesting and wonderful people up here, and I look forward to seeing them every year when I come up. Cool. I really do. Might mention Joe Pitkin, one of my favorite interesting characters.
Always doing something weird.
Takes a weird one to know one, though, Joe, I always say, you know.
Well, I've certainly had a lot of fun with you and Tom and your family and all the years.
Well, we've had
a lot of
tremendous
here and singing and
yes.
I remember coming over here so many times after Jinx's and during Jinx's, even working on the Jinx's.
Oh yes, yes, we did an awful lot of work out right out of the cottage.
Yeah, and you had the greatest collection of sheet music around.
It's still here. It's still in stacks. A lot of it I've left right up here.
Because I can remember doing a whole Jinx just through your sheet. Well, what do we have?
And yeah, right.
Bagel will have it. Everybody, Bagel, Lightner, and Tom will have it, you know? That's great. A little bit back to your family a little bit. Mr. Kaur, your father, wasn't he an executive with Ford Motor, wasn't he?
Yes, he was in charge of research and development at Ford, and they were the test tracks all over the country. He used to drive all over the country and test automobiles for the Ford Motor Company.
Well, he was the key in charge of all
mm-hmm.
that.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Actually, I remember, too, after he passed away, your mother would receive a free car every year.
Yes. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Picking out a car. And
that's right. Oh, she always drove a Lincoln. Nothing but the best, you know. This enormous Lincoln, and my mother never went anywhere. Of course, that she didn't fly. So she drove the Lincoln to the grocery store, and she drove the Lincoln over to the mall. And at the end of the year, when it was time to turn it in, my son said to her, my son who lived over there, Gage, "Nanny, are you going to turn that car in?" She said, "Yes." "How much mileage has it got on it?" 262 miles. And he looked at her and he says, "Nanny, that's obscene."
That's obscene.
But she had to have that Continental sitting outside her door.
Yeah.
And she did until the time when she was not driving anymore. And then she just didn't get a lease car anymore.
Yeah.
Yes. So.
She was quite a person, too.
Yes, she was.
She was always out front, you know, looking around.
Yes, she surveyed the property.
Cigarette, I remember, too.
Yeah, cigarette hanging out of her mouth.
Oh, she was good.
Gorgeous dressing gown in the morning. Stand on the end of the dock.
Oh, God. That's a funny story about John Reese, because Dad, I remember, heard him playing in Florida one time. So
yeah.
I just went, "Guy, is that the same fella?"
Mm-hmm.
He was,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, that trumpet playing was something, uh-huh. I guess. Uh-huh. Do you have, I remember back the old WOM Club, and just a thought, do you remember who put in those lights that we had up in the... balcony, the old with the wooden handles and made out of tin?
I don't know who put those in. They were really antiques. Probably get a bloody fortune for them if you took them to an antique show somewhere, if they'd survived a fire, you know. Uh-huh. But they really were old masterpieces, you know.
All those things were incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Incredible. Yeah, those date back so far, I can't remember. Well, Peg, that's really about it. What I want you to know is that if you have anything further that you think of, just call me and the tape will save for you. I have your
Fine.
Name on it and everything. And if there's anything you want to change or anything you want, just feel free to call me and I'll come back over. You'll be here in the fall too, right? So if you have any...
No, I won't be here in the fall, I think, this fall. No, I'm going to be kind of busy.
Well, if you think of anything while you're here,
yeah,
if you want to
okay.
add on to it, don't worry. Okay.
Okay.
Okay,
I'll
thank
do
you
that.
Very much, Peg.
Well, thank you, Joe.
It's been great. mic test, and I find the first 10 seconds or so, there's nothing on there. So. Okay, Peg, may I have your full name and date of birth, please?
Well, my name is Margaret Core Lightner. I'm Peg, and I was born on June the 29th, 1924.
Okay. Can you tell us how you came to White Lake and Sylvan Beach?
My mother and father rented a cottage at Sylvan Beach in 1959, and I brought my family, my husband and my two children and my daughter, Betsy, who hadn't been born yet. That was the year that she was born, and we rented Betsy Ross Davis's cottage that year. 2 years after that, we went down the lake and rented a cottage, and in 1962, we bought the cottage next door to what was the old Wabeningo Club from Doris Schweitzer, and that was in 1962.
Okay.
And that's how we came to White Lake.
How did the cores of your family know about White Lake?
They had a very dear friend whose name was Irene Newman, who for many, many years came and stayed at Sylvan Beach with friends and rented cottages, and they very often would come up and spend time with her here. In fact, I came up one time, oh, probably in the late 40s, and visited, and she had at that time rented what was then the Barriger Cottage. And so we stayed in that cottage that summer with Irene and with her daughter, Nancy Newman Tenega, who was a Jinx director way back when, you know, and that sort of thing. So, and that was even before Nancy was married and way before I was married. And but that was my only experience with Sylvan Beach, but Mother and Dad had fallen in love with it way back then. And
really liked it.
And once you get addicted to it, why, that's it.
Yeah, I even live here now.
So. Right.
Can you tell, were you involved, this is a question, we're going to jump ahead a bit since you mentioned it, were you involved in the Jinxes before 62?
No, no.
Okay.
Never before 62, and it was after we bought the cottage, which is where we are now, and that was the first year that I was involved in the Jinx, and it was Bob Lanier who directed that Jinx. And it was the first Jinx that my children were in.
I'll be darned, I remember.
And of course, being right next door to the Wob Club was really a bonus for us, because you could hear everything going on all day long. And we're all show business people in the Lightner family, and so it was just like a magnet for us.
Oh yeah, it was very much part of your life.
Yes, it was part. Show business had always been a part of our lives, Tom's and mine certainly up until then, and it was marvelous for us to have that for our children.
Right. I happen to, we're going to jump ahead here again, but
okay,
since you mentioned it, Tom and you used to do theater yourself, your husband Tom. Would you tell us something about Tom before we go? Past president of Sylvan Beach, Fostoria Glass.
Yes, he was, when he retired from Fostoria, he was vice president in marketing, sales,
marketing.
Advertising.
Advertising.
Yeah. Tom was a singer, he was a bass, and in Moundsville he organized a male chorus and did that. When he was in college he was in the double quartet at Amherst, that kind of thing, and was always had a gorgeous bass voice and was always a singer of songs and one thing and another. In then later years then he was the president of the hospital at home for 12 years before he died, and was on the board of directors of the West Virginia Independence Hall Foundation. So he was into that very interesting early stuff in West Virginia as well.
When did Tom get his degree in? Excuse me for a second.
If I am not mistaken, he got it in music, and the reason that he did was that he was working on a degree in mathematics, and it got to the point where he didn't want to do that mathematics anymore, so he just thought he'd finish it off in music, which is what he did. But eventually, immediately then after he got out, well then, right after he was in college, he went to the service. That was World War II.
What did he do in the service?
He was in the Army Signal Corps attached to the Navy. He was at Yalta, and then he was in the South Pacific. But he was always on a ship, even though he was in the Army.
He was like a liaison to the Army and
the encoding and cryptogram, all that sort of thing is what he did.
Did he see much action?
I think not. I don't remember that he ever said anything about any action, and I think he probably would have over all those years.
Yeah. Uh-huh. What rank did he leave the service at?
Was he a sergeant, I think? He was not an officer. He was a non-com. That's
He'd
all
be
I can
a classic
tell.
Sergeant. I could hear Tom's voice, you know.
Yes, very loud voice. He could call those cadences, couldn't he, pretty
I bet
well?
He could.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And the sergeants are what make everything work, so that's a very important job.
Yes.
Very important. Did you two meet in college? Or?
No. I went to the University of Michigan. He went to Amherst. He went back to Cleveland to work after the war. I came to West Virginia. I went to West Virginia to set up a speech correction program in the public schools in the Wheeling, West Virginia area. I went there in the fall of 1947. He went to Moundsville, West Virginia, which is 12 miles from Wheeling, in the spring of 1948. The way that we met was in a little theater production of a show called Two Blind Mice, about two little old ladies who were running a defunct government agency which had been canceled and they didn't know it. And I was the ingenue and he was, an Army or Navy officer. Actually, I didn't like him much because Tom always thought, I don't need to learn these lines, I'll think of something. I'm like George Arliss. You say it the same way every single time, and I want that cue. So there we were, the two of us. Tom was that way about singing, too. If you didn't know the words to a song, you could just sing Watermelon all the time, and nobody would know the difference.
Very casual approach.
Yeah, right, very casual approach, and I used to get so mad at him. And then we started dating,
And then from there on, it just went. But, you know, I think that was one of Tom's greatest qualities, was that he had the ability to be casual in situations that
laid back,
pressure,
yeah. Laid back.
And I think that's a beautiful, he was a wonderful gift to us all that mm-hmm. way.
Yes, he always wanted peace, harmony
yes.
was his thing. You know, don't argue,
yeah.
Think of some other way. There must be another way to do it. That was what he always was about.
Yeah, he's sorely mm-hmm. missed, and we need more of that type yes. in this world yeah. nowadays.
Well, we all miss him a lot.
Yeah.
We really
yeah,
do.
Very wonderful man. Mm-hmm. Later on, he became president of Sylvan Beach, right? And
yes, he did.
He was on the board and various...
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, he was.
Could you tell us the capacities he had on the board?
Let me see. What did he do in particular? That's kind of hard to say.
Loaded question.
it really is because each president gives to it what he thinks it needs to have, and what he wanted for us to do. There were two or three things. He wanted us to communicate with each other better. His big thing was communicating with people, and it was while Tom was president that Charlie Dupre came to him and suggested doing the Sylvan Tides.
Okay.
And Tom just grabbed it because he thought, whoa, this is what I want. This is communicating. Mm-hmm. And that was very important to Tom, was communicating with people and for people to be able to communicate with the board. He encouraged them to please bring your comments to the board if you have them, and that kind of thing. He was his other thing was plant trees. Plant trees. He was big on trees. He thought you ought to be planting trees. And after he died, the board of directors planted a tree right next to the post office for him. It's a little dogwood tree. And his children planted a blue spruce in the yard beside the house for him. So we planted two trees. Two trees have been planted on Sylvan Beach for Tom.
And well, I think both of those things, especially with Charlie Dupre having been on Sylvan Tides.
Yeah, Tom was really pleased with that. And I think that has been a tremendous addition. A tremendous addition.
Well, it's always fun to look at. It's always waiting.
Well, it
to
is.
Get
it's our communication with each other all year long, and it keeps us. I'm always delighted to see it come in the mail. You know, hot dog, here it
yeah.
is. You know,
we'll see who's been born, and let's go.
You're right. Yes.
That's great. That's great. You mentioned something earlier. I guess we go to that. Is the Wabeningo Club Fire? The Wabeningo Club. That was. Can you tell us when that was?
Yes, it was in April of 1979. Strangely enough, my daughter Betsy Lightner, now Langston, had directed The Jinx in 1978, and as it turned out, it was the last Jinx in the old Wabeningo Club. And that fire was in the spring of 1979, April, I don't remember an exact date.
Now, didn't your cottage suffer a great
deal? Yes, the cottage was burned to the ground along with it because it sat right next to the Wob Club. And we'd always said, if it goes, we go. And that was so. It did. The blessed fireman managed to save the garage.
Yeah.
It's still the same little old garage that was always there.
That's true, too.
But not the house. It had to be rebuilt from the bottom up.
And you lost a tremendous amount of history there, too, didn't you?
Yes.
Jinxes and...
Yes. Well, that was interesting because I had been used to leaving my jinx things in the cottage from one year to the next. And that was the first thing I thought of when Dwayne Pearson called. I was on the board at that time, and Dwayne Pearson was president of the board of directors, and he called to tell us about it. And my first thought was, I left all those jinx things up there. Don't you know, about a month later, I looked on the top shelf of my closet and I had brought them home.
Oh my God. Miracles of
miracles. Miracle of miracles. For some reason, I had brought those home. Somebody said to me, take those home this year.
I'll be darned. Speaking of that fire, did they ever figure out what caused that fire? Do you know?
It was either an electrical fire. It was either an electric line or lightning. And I don't know that there was ever any way they could tell.
To figure it out.
It was a storm and a very high wind, a 50-mile-an-hour wind, that east wind that comes off of White Lake. And it was like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And apparently somebody coming in through the channel in a boat saw the fire and called somebody.
Yeah, I think that was Mike Esch, as a matter of
fact. Is that right?
Yeah, I went banged on the caretaker's door, didn't find anybody.
Yes,
Then went up to Jim Harris's house, and from there they called the police or fire department. I remember Jim Harris, just as a real short aside, the intensity of the fire was so great that Mr. Harris told me that as he woke up on the inside of his walls in his cottage, that all you could see was red, the flame
was
so intense.
Yes. Yes.
We're lucky that a lot more was lost.
Yes, we're lucky about a lot of things. We're lucky that it happened when the season was not in full swing.
Right.
Because there were not a lot of people around. And so far as I know, there was nobody was injured, nobody, you know, and there were no deaths associated with it. And you have to be thankful for the people, at any rate, in that.
Oh, yes. The firemen did a tremendous job. I don't know how they did it. Your history with, you can't say the word jinx and not say Lightner. Can you tell us how you got involved in the jinx?
I'd be delighted to tell you what happened. I sent my children over when the morning came, having signed them up for it. You will sign up for that. Well, they didn't mind. That's fine with them. So I went over when Betsy, who was the little one, was in the little children's act. And Bob Lanier's over there, and he's got, and at that point, he must have had 24 kids in that little kid's age group, you know, had a whole stage full of all of them.
Yeah, that post-Second World War.
Yes, and they were the first ones to practice in the morning. It was like 9 o'clock in the morning. And I went over to watch the practice. Well, as you know, that old Wobbenigo Club didn't have a bathroom.
Okay.
You know. And here were all these little tiny people that had just come from home and been hurried down by mother. And there were about 5 or 6 of them standing there with their legs crossed. And I went up to Bob and I said, if anybody needs to go to the bathroom, you can go over to the Lightners. So I took everybody that needed by the little hand and brought them over to the cottage and took them to the bathroom and took them back over. And the next day when I went over to watch the practice and all the little legs crossed, Bob turned around and said, Mrs. Lightner! And I took the little people next door and took them to the bathroom and took them back. That was my first association with the jinx.
I'll be darned.
And I think then I played a little rehearsal piano here and there, you know. Just mostly I just put children in it and helped make costumes and do for them what needed to be done.
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, why don't we pause for 1 second and
okay.
We'll reattach that. Okay, Peg. We were talking about jinxes, and you brought up a very good... just start with your history of jinxes. You were at the Bob Lanier in 62.
Yeah, Bob Lanier was in 62. And
by the way, his father has a reel-to-reel of that jinx tape.
I know that he has.
Yeah.
I know that he has. They tried, the years later when Betsy Lightner did her Jinx in 78, she wanted to call it That's Entertainment, and I said, you can't, there wasn't That's Entertainment, and it was Bob Lanier. So she asked Bob and Connie if it'd be all right with them if she called it That's Entertainment too, which she did.
That's right, yeah.
If you'll remember that.
Yeah, uh-huh. That's right.
Well, let's proceed along here and see what else we can find here. That was 62.
When did you become the entertainment? Weren't you in charge of...
I was the recreation chairman. That was some later. I don't remember, Joe, exactly the year. But I was doing Jinxes before I was doing that.
Yeah.
Because I don't think there was ever a year when I wasn't really into the Jinx thing.
Oh, that's very true.
it was just kind of one of those things. Well, not 66. It was 67, maybe? Yeah, 67, Happiness Is. That Tom and I directed it first. And I might not tell you what was in that, if anything that you might. It's fun to go back over these old programs, which will be available, and I know there are a lot of people that have programs, Joe.
Yeah.
Yeah, if they have not come out of the woodwork yet, there are people who do have lots of these old programs around. And you might put out a call to see if you can get together a complete set. It would be fun to see if you could get a set of those together. And this is one that I really love doing. That was Up, Up, and Away. And Joe, you did the second half of that. You remember?
Oh,
you were Boss Greed.
Greed, was that Boss?
You were Boss Greed, and that was 1967. Huh? No, 1968.
Yeah.
That was 1968. Yeah.
Ward Josephson was Terrington or Harrigan or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was the first Jinx you did, right? That was the first.
The first one that we did was in '67. It was called Happiness Is.
Now was Jane Goodman was involved?
Jane Goodman was very much involved in it. She was because when they said they wanted us to direct the first act, Betsy Davis did that one, and you. Did that with Betsy. You did the second half. We did the musical direction for the first half.
Okay.
And I'm not that good a dancer, and I knew where the dancer was. It was my sister, Jane Goodman. And so I just said, please come along here and do this dancing. So I'm not sure she did very much in 67, but in 68, she danced everybody. Everybody in the show danced. You know, and that it was a lot of fun because that was the first time they did that Straw Hat and Cane number, which has survived year after year after year. And I'm happy to say now they're doing some different things with that and adding some things to it besides that.
Yes,
you know?
I was going to ask you about that. It was a Lightner edition.
It was really Jane Goodman who started it. And I picked up on it because she hasn't been able to be here for a good many years. And it's really... just kind of something that's fun to do.
Exactly.
And the guys like to do it. It's kind of a fun act for them. It's sort of like the kick line with the girls, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of nice to have an act that they like to do. And then all of a sudden one year the guys will decide, I want to do a Hat and Cane, let's do something different. One year they did that thing, do-wah-diddy-diddy-dum-diddy-do, instead. They threw away the hats and canes and did that instead. And it was wonderful. It was just really great to watch that.
Very good number. In that time, your husband made several appearances.
Oh, yeah, he was in.
Can you recall some of those for us?
Yes, I sure can. The first one that he was in was On a Clear Day You Can See Milwaukee.
Oh, wasn't that Amy Hunter's?
Let's see. I can see. No, that was Betsy Davis and Ted Edson.
Okay.
Who did that one. And that was also the first one. Betsy Lightner and Duffy Peterson sang "Nothing Could Be Finer Than to Greet the Carolina in the Morning." And Sally Summer and Tom Lightner sang "Bye Bye Baby."
Yes.
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 So that.
So yeah, that they,
that was the, yeah, that was the first one that Tom was in. And he got into a lot of the others too. He sang "Miss America" one year and had all the little beauties carrying all those gladiolas around on the stage. And he sang "Luck Be a Lady Tonight" one year. He sang "The Girl from Ipanema" one year with a little kick line of girls behind it. The best one, the most outstanding one, and the one that people will remember him from was "Sending the Clowns." And that was in Betsy's Jinx, and Betsy set that number up and had the girls on one side of the stage in white face and white gloves to do a mime, and he sang "Sending the Clowns." And it really was a very effective number.
Oh, it was. Mm-hmm. But you know, the one that my favorite one he did, I mean, that was a superb one, I don't know why, my favorite one that Tom did was "Me and My Shadow." Didn't he sing "Me"?
No, he didn't. No. He didn't sing that. Betsy sang it.
Okay, but wasn't he out there with her?
No, Jane Goodman was. Aunt Jane.
Okay, I'm
Betsy and her Aunt Jane. Betsy was the little one in the front, and she sang it.
Okay.
And then Jane came on with the spot in the back and was the shadow behind her.
Okay, I'm wrong there. I remember.
Uh-huh,
it's funny.
Uh-huh.
So it was Jane and Betsy did that.
Yeah, Jane and Betsy did that.
"Sending the Clowns" would have to be Tom's classic then.
Yeah, that would really be his classic.
Yeah. How many years did Jane work on the Jinx, help with the Jinx?
Oh, 4 or 5 probably.
4 or 5
mm-hmm.
years, yeah.
Mm-hmm. The years that she was up here with her family.
Yeah.
And then things changed in her life, and she wasn't ever able to come up here much mm-hmm. after that.
How many Jinxes did you work in, you and Tom? My God,
I don't think I can remember that, Joe. Well, we started in 62, and I'll tell you, It's been a rare year that I haven't been involved in it,
yeah.
One way or another.
Well, that's my memory. You've always been
yes.
involved, you and Tom and everyone.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, everybody in the family enjoyed it, even the year that when we did that up and away. And anyone who remembers it will know that we used balloons. And we needed helium balloons. And so my mother decided she would be the angel. Mabel Corr decided she would provide the balloons and the helium tanks, which were pretty expensive for our budget. But at any rate, we just had balloons all over everywhere, and then we had a big net. We had found an old tennis net and suspended it in the Wob Club and filled it with balloons. And at the end of the performance, we dumped it. And the people up in the balcony in the back were very upset with us because they couldn't take pictures because the balloons were in the between them and the stage. So that was when we had to put the photographer on a ladder downstairs, if you'll remember.
I remember that. As a matter of fact, I remember blowing up the balloons.
Out in the back of this cottage back here. Yeah.
Filling them both days, you know,
uh-huh.
for the Jinx.
Filling them both days. Yeah, and putting that tennis net up.
Yeah, that was a rhyme.
Spending part of your time changing your voice with the helium out of the balloons as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, this is always fun.
Had to do a little of that.
You know, I've got some slides of that. It was funny because you can see the balloons and net in the top of your frame.
Yeah, right.
What, of course, there can never be a best Jinx or a favorite Jinx.
No, I don't think so. Every year everybody says it's the best Jinx there ever was, and it's always true because each
right.
Jinx has its own
special.
Neat, special things about it and things that you remember from each year.
That's very true. And everyone, as you say, is the best ever.
Yeah, that's right.
What were some of your favorite numbers that she did? The ones that you had fun with or the ones that you loved?
Oh, I really enjoyed watching the first time that Hat and Cane number when Jane directed it. And she must have had 16 or 18 boys, 8 to 12 year old boys on the stage, and it was Doug Schaefer and Gage Lightner and Brad Schaefer and Greg Rogers and all, and Jimmy Field and Jim Rice and Bob Mills. Yeah, it was that whole particular bunch of people. And they really looked great. And 8 to 12-year-old boys are not the most graceful things in the whole world altogether. But Aunt Jane was determined that they were going to dance. And they did. And they did it extremely well. They truly did. Oh, it's hard for me to tell you ones that I think were the best. I think the kick line that Jane did when they did Let the Sunshine In, and Chip Forster and Tom Lightner and Chris Netto made those big light boxes, those flashing light boxes that we had on either side of the stage, great big ones, and they got those blinker things, you know, went all over everywhere to get those, and found all these different colored gels and put that together. And then Jane put together this Let the Sunshine In, which was quite different from anything the girls had done. And it was really very effective. It was a kind of a neat number. She did one to Everything's Coming Up Roses that was pretty good too. And the girls had red roses in their top hats. That was well done.
Can you think of any others, any numbers that all through the years that you enjoyed or different?
I'll tell you one, and Betsy Davis and I both said this, and the reason that we keep thinking about it is we wish we'd been in the right age to be in it, and that was one that Gail Griner did in her Jinx, and it was Don't Cry For Me, Wabanengo. And those gorgeous girls in all these gorgeous clothes and bare feet singing Don't Cry For Me, Wabanengo.
I thought that was a Wisdom who did that, Jinx.
No, I don't think so. I think that was Gail's.
Okay, but that was a wonderful number.
And then they did a repeat a couple years later, If I Had a Rich Man, instead of If I Were a Rich Man, you know. They did, that same crowd did that in all these, the best looking glitzy clothes they could find to wear, you know. And they looked absolutely wonderful. And Betsy Davis and I were both jealous. We wanted to be in that number.
Oh, it was a great number. It was, yes. Especially the Don't Cry For Me, Wabanengo.
Yeah, I thought that was really quite special. Some of the ones that have been created as the show progresses have been fun to watch, too. There was one that four boys did with Grecian Urns. Which was a lot of fun, and I don't remember. That may have been one of Gail's Jinxes, too. Because it was Toby Roosevelt.
The Goss Boys.
Or was it a Goss or two? Anna McCall. You know, some of those kids that were in that.
That was an excellent.
And it was well conceived and well put together, you know. And it was something that was an addition to what the director had put together, which I think is always neat. If you can put extra things like that in it, you know, that make the icing on what's always a nice cake anyway.
No, you're right. Those are some of the best acts or the last minute ones thrown in. Are some of the best acts. What Broadway musicals influenced you most, do you think?
Well, any Rodgers and Hammerstein. Any one of them. Cole Porter. Lerner and Lowe, you know.
And how do you feel about Broadway nowadays? What's happened to it? Why?
I just look for the revivals, because most of the new stuff, to begin with, I haven't been able to go and see most of it. I just this last winter got to see Phantom of the Opera. Now, to me, that's wonderful stuff. I love Cats. You know, some of that Andrew Lloyd Webber's things are all really quite fantastic. I really can't tell you much about the other new things. I know that Tommy Toon has done some wonderful stuff. And I've never been able to get to where one of them. I've never been seen any of his work. I've seen him on the television a lot, of course, and I think he's extremely talented, extremely good. But it's kind of fun to see the revivals that they get together. Yeah. When they brought back Gypsy, I very much wanted to go and see, who was the one that was in Cagney and Lacey that took that part? And I wanted to go and see her in it so badly. Tyne Daly did it. And I got to see Ethel Merman in that years ago, you see. And that Ethel Merman and Jack Klugman were in it together. And I wanted to see it done by somebody else. I also got to see Carol Channing do Hello, Dolly.
Oh, wow.
You see, some of those things, I got to see Mary Martin do South Pacific and Izzy Opinza. You know, those are some of the things that, this is the reason I look for, you know.
For the revival.
These things are all so great in my mind, you know.
Why do you think America went through a period like that, where we had so much good coming out of Broadway in such a short amount of time? We went after
Broadway, all of these wonderful show tunes and things started coming when, I think it was Oklahoma, wasn't it?
Oklahoma, the first one.
Yeah, right, was the first one. It was a whole new dimension. It was taking a play that was not necessarily funny, but putting it to music and putting all kinds of things in it. Good, bad, tragedy, comedy, you know, and that sort of thing, and coming up with that. But and then it just progressed on from that. There have been lots of wonderful things that have come out of rather depressing movies, books. But then you can lift it with a musical.
Like Carousel was fairly depressing in a way, but mm-hmm.
Yes, but that's my favorite.
That is my favorite
musical all time.
That is
all time.
Too.
Yeah,
there's so much good music in that thing. It's just
yes.
But my favorite is "If I Loved You Time and Again, I Would Try to Say." Mm-hmm. You know, I love that. All those mm-hmm. songs were excellent. June. Uh-huh. When You Walk Through a Storm.
Every number in that is just great. I got a very. This hasn't got anything to do with Sylvan Beach, but I had seen Tom and I had seen Carousel in New York one time or another. And then it was going to come to Wheeling, the truck and bus was going to come to Wheeling. And it's a big theater, and good stuff comes there. I've seen an awful lot of stuff there I wouldn't have seen if it weren't there. I took all three of my children and Gage's girlfriend at the time to see it. And we got in the theater, and it's the wintertime. And we sat, and pretty soon, John Raitt, it was his company, came out and said to us, "Folks, we are here. This is a theater with 2,300 people in it, every seat full. We are here. Our trucks have not come in. We have nothing. We have one score. We have been able, thanks to CA House, the music company locally, to get some instruments together. The only instruments they had were the ones that people had carried in their hands. That, you know, they didn't have any of their big, no drums, no, you know, no, those things that you need. So they'd gotten together what they could. And he said, "We are going to go ahead and give you a show tonight, but it will be done in modern dress and without props and without scenery. If you would like to have your money back, please go to the box office, because we understand how you feel." Not one soul left that theater. That was some performance.
Oh,
it was every bit as good as if they'd had costumes and props and everything else. And at the end, where they have that star, and they tell him where to hang the star, he handed it up to him and says, "Hang this star over Wheeling, West Virginia, with all my love." You know?
Wow.
At the end of the show, he brought the entire cast out on the stage, and they sang every song from every show they'd ever been in. They just sang.
What a wonderful.
And he came back the next year with Pajama Gabe.
Oh,
and we did, and of course that show just went on as planned, but he still brought them all out in front and sang for us at the end. He said that it was because of Wheeling, West Virginia that he got on the front cover of Variety. Because of that performance that they gave.
Oh, that must have been a spectacular experience.
It was a very interesting experience, and my kids were just. It was a good lesson for them in how you can go ahead and do it.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be a set way.
Radio
you can manage.
Why can't this?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Use your imagination. You know?
That's right. Uh-huh.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So it was really fun. Really fun.
That's an incredible story. just as an aside, we have, of course, Betsy Davis. Betsy Ross Davis was in Oklahoma. And
yes,
Carousel,
she was. And Carousel.
With
yes.
John Ray.
Yes, indeed so.
Certainly. But I've heard also she was in Oklahoma with Joel Grey was in it at that time.
Is that right?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Mr. Schmidt was telling me that, mm-hmm. that they had an experience when the show toured. Uh-huh. So did you ever get to, you and Tom, every summer, as long as I can remember, you've been into Broadway, you never missed anything on Broadway that was worth anything. Did you ever get to know any of the stars or people or have any experiences?
No.
Mm-mm. Just that one.
No.
With John Raitt's cast.
Yeah, that's about as close.
Incredible.
Yeah, I can't think. One time we went to have dinner at Sardi's after we'd been to see, I know, we were going to see Where's Charlie? Ray Bolger's Where's Charlie? And we were having dinner at Sardi's first, and I heard somebody laugh behind me, and I thought, Ray Bolger! And I turned around, and it was. And the gal that was with me kept saying, Babe, will you turn around and eat your dinner? We have to go to the theater, because I kept looking at him. You know, I'm sure he didn't care.
No,
he's used to being looked at.
Yeah.
But we're paying a fortune to eat in Sardi's. You might as well eat your dinner, you know.
Now,
I guess that may be as close as I ever got to really meeting any of them.
So you would rank probably Carousel as your favorite
part? Yes, Carousel.
And then after Carousel, what would you, how would you go down the list there?
Well, I'll tell you another one that, when the end of that thing came, I wanted to stay and see it again. And that was Kismet. And that was Alfred Drake, and Alfred Drake was something else.
Yeah.
He was in Kiss Me, Kate, and he was in Oklahoma. And then he was in Kiss Me, Kate, and he was in Kismet.
Some awful good tunes from Kismet.
Kismet, oh yeah. I don't know that any of them take my hand. I'm a stranger in paradise. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Baubles, bangles, and beads.
Well, that was from your tune.
Yeah.
Oh, God, uh-huh. I love it. That sounds like a Stan Freeberg tune, you know. Baubles, bangles, bright. That's fair. What would you rank third or fourth?
Let me see. Oh, that's so hard. I saw one 1,000 years ago with B. Lilly in it. B. Lilly, and Jack Haley called Inside USA. And there was a little number in that I thought was just dialing. It's called Little Old Rhode Island Was Famous for You. And it was like, pencils come from Pennsylvania, vests from West Virginia. But why should you be blue? They know mink where they grow mink in Wyoming. A camp chair in New Hampshire, that's for me. You know, it was just, that was a neat song. One neat song, Jack Haley sang that. Beatrice Lilly, who was the neatest clown in the world, absolutely great. I would love to have been Beatrice Lilly. I could have seen myself being Beatrice Lilly. But she directed a little opus called Come, Oh Come to Pittsburgh with full chorus, everybody, and with her back to the audience, doing all sorts of weird things with her body and scratching her legs and scratching her behind, you know. It's just funny little things that turn up in your head.
Uh-huh.
A lot of things that a lot of people don't even remember or maybe didn't even see. Turn her off.
Take a pause. Well, we had to take a little break there to spray for spiders.
That's right.
So,
says he's done almost everybody on the beach except mine and the lady next door, so.
Always, that stuff smells, I'll tell you. We're on Broadway plays, and that we're talking about different shows, your favorite shows. Do you have any more that you can remember that you saw that were outstanding performances?
Guys and Dolls.
Guys and Dolls. Now, who was in that when you saw that?
Robert Alda, Vivian Blaine. I can't think. I mix it up with the movie now, you know, because it's been a long time since I've seen that Guys and Dolls. But that was the original Guys and Dolls. It wasn't this recent one. It was way back when I used to sneak in and go with Tom to New York when he went on business, and then I'd just go see shows the whole time that I was there. And those were back in the days when you could afford to go to three or four shows when you went to New York.
Yeah. Yeah.
different.
Right, yeah. Right.
Yeah. Again, what do you have any idea about why we aren't producing the Broadway plays we did at one time, the amount of great ones? You know, we seem to have gone through a heyday there for 15, 20 years, the end of the second.
Oh, I think it'll happen again. Yeah.
It's like most things will come around again.
Yes. You just have to wait for the combination of people to come along to do them. It seemed like Lloyd Webber came along and did a number of very nice ones. And then a good many people have done maybe one or two. And then there are names that you don't remember because you don't hear them again and again, which is kind of too bad because they may have been something that was just as good as others that you've seen.
That's true. If there's not that staying power type of thing, then you might not remember as much. Mm-hmm. So you really don't have any social interpretation of what may have happened?
No, I really don't. Who knows?
Who knows, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It isn't as if there weren't audiences there for them.
Yeah.
And there still are those.
Yeah.
Even in a little place like Wheeling, West Virginia, because when they offered us a little package, which was Singing in the Rain and Cats, 1 year, our local television station got together this little package of truck and bus for us. And of course, we all immediately sent for the two of them. They sold out Cats so fast that they asked them if they could give them another night, and they said no, the cast of Cats, they couldn't do it, but if you'd wait, change the date to the end of the tour, we'll come for three nights, which they did. And they filled that 2,300 seat thing three nights in a row. So even in an area like that, it just, people are crying for the good stuff,
people,
you know?
Love it, yeah.
Yeah,
you know,
lots of people are, lots of people are.
And I think if anybody ever catches on to bring it back in any strength,
see, that's,
it'll be very successful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. People are starving for their greatness.
Mm-hmm.
Go on.
No, that's right. I just wondered I keep hoping that some of these good revivals will encourage some younger people to create some stuff of their own, you know, because they're reviving these things because there's anything else. They haven't got enough new stuff to...
Yeah.
And yet, you don't want all these wonderful old things to die out. You need to see them again now and again,
right.
And they need to be done. And of course, so many of them are done now by community theaters and that kind of thing, and those are fun to see, too. Those are fun to see. It's fun to see the locals do them. It really is. And they turn in some wonderful performances.
Oh,
just wonderful performances.
Great people out there that never go on stage. It could be just as good as any of them, I think.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I'll tell you one that I've seen, and I've seen it in New York about four times, and that was the Fantastics.
Oh, God.
And I think that's an unforgettable experience. I think everybody ought sometime or other to get to see that.
Oh, I agree. When Cynthia Neely sang, Try to...
Yes, I remember that. That was my first introduction to that.
Well, same here. That was the first thing I ever knew about Fantastics. And what a wonderful little act that was. What a great act that was.
Uh-huh.
What a loss she was.
Oh, yes. I remember her with a lot of love and affection.
Yeah, that's true.
A very talented little gal.
Speaking of, we're talking about Broadway and about maybe the stuff that we used to turn out isn't being turned out and things like that. Is there a reflection of that, do you see, in Jinxes as the time has gone on? For instance, you can remember when we had the Bob Lanier's and the Stevie McClave sets.
Uh-huh.
And we had Doug Schmidt's, we had a lot of those things. And now we don't seem to have the sets or people painting or doing things that they used to do. Do you have any idea why that is? Not that it's bad or good or anything.
I think probably a lot of that is that our younger people are not spending as much time in the summers at White Lake as they were able to do.
Yeah.
In those years when you came up with your family at the beginning of the summer, you stayed all summer.
And school didn't begin until
after Labor Day, you know, and it was Memorial Day to Labor Day or 4th of July to Labor Day or whatever. And the world has just changed. It's different, and I know that it's frustrating for, people your age. And see, you talked about Doug Schmidt, who did those things. Well, he's still doing it.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, he's still into it big time, you know, that kind of thing. Buffy Tukey's another one who had a lot of talent.
Yeah.
along those lines.
She did.
And there have been others, lots of others, who've created stuff along those lines. Buffy is a graphic artist and went to the Art Institute in Chicago. You see, she's still doing that kind of thing. And that sort of person is still going to come along, but you don't see them up here so often when they're young, because they don't get to spend their whole summers up here.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, we were very privileged to live in that golden Second World War age.
That's right. That's right. And it'll never come back.
No.
But they are years to remember and to treasure.
Oh, I don't think, you know, I often...
To treasure.
Yeah, oh, exactly. They're mm-hmm. the most special times in history, almost, mm-hmm. to have been alive during that period, mm-hmm. the post-Second World War.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And the affluency of this country and what it did for a few.
Yes.
It was very great. Buffy Tukey was another one you mentioned. Can you think of others? Helen Rice was...
Oh, Helen Rice, yes. She was a very talented... I hate to call out names, because you can't call out all of the talented people. And people who just turned up out of nowhere and turned out to be so useful and helpful. Susie Carnwath.
Oh, exactly. Susie Carnwath.
And bless her heart, she came over there and just great with the dancers. And the singers.
Yeah.
She taught those little gals that were doing the kick line how to change their voice from one octave to the next one. She gave them a singing lesson one day so that they could do it without belting, you know. That sort of thing, just little things like that, and she just—it was great to have her
here.
Oh,
she was incredible.
Just great.
She just walked in the door one day, and that was it.
Can I help? And this is what happens. And there are still people like that around.
Yeah.
The thing that's happened with the Jinx is because people are not here all summer long, it makes it a little harder for the director, because the director has to kind of stand still until it gets close to time, because then people get their time off and they come up here. And then they go to the director and say, can I help?
Yeah.
And that's hard for a director to do, is to be able to hold still and know it is going to come together.
Yeah.
Somebody will pull the curtain. Somebody will work the lights. You know, there will be somebody there to do those things.
Yeah.
And it always works out that way.
Yeah. Well, you're right. It always comes.
It always comes off, and it's always great.
It's that loss of control that scares everybody.
I think that's it. That's it. You think to yourself, what's happening here? I don't know what's going on here. Why don't I know what's going on here? You know? And you think to yourself, I'm not in control here. What's, you know? But if you can just hang on to yourself with it,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Can you remember anything things that happened during Jinxes that weren't planned, accidents or mistakes?
Well, I'll tell you one thing we had with that old Wob Club was that curtain. And the curtain just... We'd get it fixed. We'd get the people out here, and we'd get the curtain fixed, and we'd get the track fixed. And it would work fine up until the time for the performance, and then one of the curtains wouldn't come open. And so you'd have to stand there, and somebody'd have to stand there and hold the curtain open for every act.
Oh, yeah, and then it'd get stuck.
Finally, one year we just said, all right, the money this year is going to a new track. And we took down the old track. I had the stage full of people taking out hooks, repairing tears, sewing new hooks into the curtain until we got it all right, and they took down the old track, put a new track up, and we put the curtain up. By George, we had a curtain that opened both sides every night. And I don't even... Oh, that's been a long time ago, though.
That curtain was... I remember one classic incident when Mimi Gillen, during the kick line, lost her... skirt, and then they tried to get the curtain closed, and the curtain wouldn't close halfway through it. And there was always something.
Yes, there were
those little incidents.
Right.
Do you remember anything else that happened during the Jinx that weren't exactly planned but occurred, or any?
Oh, well, they do. You know, something always does.
How about the lighting? Yeah, I mean, those footlights were always, to me, dangerous at best.
Oh, yes, they truly were. That was one of the things. When there was a point at which we put the lights up behind the stage, was that after we built the new clubhouse? I guess it was.
Yeah.
That we did not put any lights on the stage, simply because of that many children and the kind of things you wanted to do, like steam heat, where you were blowing heat around, and people using water pistols for this or that, or you know, making temporary messes on the stage and that sort of thing. And those old lights on that old Wob Club stage were pretty iffy at best, you know. That stage was very high off of the the floor anyway, you know, and it was...
Well, I can remember being on stage with water and things being thrown around. I can remember a couple times watching smoke rise from out of the footlights.
That was always a worry. To me, it was, when I was doing it, was a worry for the little children, was those footlights and keeping them away from the footlights.
Yeah, very good point, because those were dangerous at best. Do you, what back when you started doing these jinxes, were involved in them, now we have a very wonderful stage and everything, a lot of fancy stuff, and we have a telephone between upstairs and the lighting and downstairs. What did you used to do for the lighting? To communicate from backstage up to the lighting.
It seems to me we had one of those walkie-talkies. You know, there was some kind of communication there with the spotlights. And then occasionally you just say to them, in this number you do this, and in this number you do that, and be on, you know, you're on your own.
Yeah.
You're up there and I'm down here, and never the twain shall meet, so do it.
And then there's the people that every once in a while somebody would just lean their head out from backstage and look up there. And
yeah, right. Yes, there's that too.
On the old things that happened with the Jinx, who was in the speaking? We certainly have to cover who played for the Jinx those years that you were involved.
The years that I was involved with it. Well, Carol Krause. Now Carol Burnett played piano for many, many years and is still to this day a very, very good friend of mine. And of course, Mary Lynn Andreessen has gone and borrowed a bass fiddle and been there every year for us.
For how many years?
I can't tell you, but you see, she did it when her father, Harold Mulder, was playing piano and doing the Jinxes. So I suppose all of her life she's been doing that. And she enjoys that. She plans to be here to do that because she likes doing it. And then we've had, for a long time we had Earl Launouet on the drums.
A fine man.
Absolutely the greatest. Betsy Lightner called him Earl Baby. She just thought he was the greatest thing in the world. Yes, and his wife was Lorna Baby. They were just, he was just something else.
He was just very kind.
He was a wonderful man. Wonderful man, and a terrific drummer.
Yeah.
Yes.
He loved those drums.
Yes, he surely did. And then after that, we've had various and sundry other drummers. Sonny Pops played the drums, and Scott Johnson played the drums.
And Joe Carnwith.
And Joe Carnwith played the drums, and Sean Manny played the drums. You know, over the years, somebody has turned up to do it. There have been now a number of different pianists in the last years too, and I don't really remember most of the names of those pianists, but they're again all just fine, you know. You get on the property and go after it, and somehow Bob Drew's another one that's played a lot of piano.
That's right. Mr. Bob,
he's now on the board of directors, so he's still with us, and he enjoys it too.
Very good man.
He's just super. Just super.
As a matter of fact, you can't think of very many that are around here.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
It's a wonderful situation.
Mm-hmm.
Very kind. Do you remember dress rehearsals that were particularly bad?
Every one of them was bad. I never knew a good dress rehearsal. But then we always said that's a sign of a good show. I think if I'd had a good dress rehearsal, I'd have thought, wait a minute. What's it going to be like tomorrow night, you know?
Yeah, we're clicking too well.
But when you have a bad dress rehearsal, there's nowhere to go but up. So, you know.
That's right.
And I think it kind of scares everybody. Oh, I can't be that bad tomorrow night. I got to be better than that, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Well, keeps up the gas.
Yes, right.
Speaking of that, did you ever figure out a momentum to the Jinx? For instance, if it was really good Friday night, when Saturday night everybody's kind of off because it was so good, or vice versa. Could you ever put any rhyme or reason to the whole spectacle in any way like that?
No. A lot of people I know would buy tickets and go one of the two nights. I always bought enough tickets so I could go both nights, you know, because I always wanted to see, you know, it's something's going to be different. And over the years, people will, some of these, the older kids that are still Jinx babies are turn up at the end of the week and can't get the act together for Friday night, but they can get it together on Saturday. And then if the director will let them, they get to do it on Saturday night. And so if you don't go Saturday night, you it's a different show from Friday
That's
night
right.
sometimes.
And many times skits are thrown in there that you
yeah.
can only do.
Besides that, the acts are never the same two nights in a row.
That's right.
You know?
Well, they rehearse for 13 days.
You're right. You should expect perfection, I suppose, huh? Well, that wouldn't be any fun.
Okay, what fun, speaking of fun, what was the most fun Jinx you ever worked with? I mean, just was fun.
I really think that Up, Up, and Away, I don't know what it was. It was just the combination of everything that just went together just that particular time.
That's always been probably my favorite.
Yeah.
I think of it
because it was the easiest one. You know, it kind of fell together. All the numbers kind of fell together.
Yes.
And if I remember correctly, that was the year that my sister and I kept calling each other up back and forth across the country and suggesting numbers. So that by the time we got up here, we had all the numbers and we had reworded everything we were going to. We had all of it done ahead of time.
That's right.
So, and I don't know, that's another thing that you could do then. You could do that.
You
have to wait now until you see how many people you have for different things. In those days, you had so many people that you had to split groups in order to get them all on the stage. The first kick line that I ever saw, which was the one that Bob Lanier did, which was
yes.
Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend. I don't know that I've seen a better one since. Now, all the girls are wonderful. But that was a double kick line. There were so many of them. It was two lines on the stage.
It was our age group, Dede Josephson, and Martha
yes,
Bradford,
it was.
All those people.
Yeah, Mickey Murphy, Betsy Bogart, you know, that whole crowd.
Yeah.
And it was elegant. And I know that he rehearsed them a lot because my bedroom was on this side of the cottage, which was where the Wob Club was. And at 5 o'clock, I'm getting dressed for dinner. And at 5 o'clock in the Wob Club, he's rehearsing A Kiss on the Hand, maybe every day for 3 weeks. Now, he rehearsed them for 3 weeks. So it's something you can't do anymore either. It has to be two because you don't have the time. But every day for 3 weeks at 5 o'clock, this is what I heard. And I kept thinking, I ought to go see what he's doing. And then I thought, no, let it be a surprise for you. You know, and I was very surprised and delighted with it.
Yeah,
when
I
saw it, because it was that was as close to a perfect number as you're going to get.
Yeah, that's funny you mentioned that one because that's the one I always remembered as my
yes.
favorite.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we mentioned the name, and Bob Lanier did that Jinx, and Bob is not here now. He's mm-hmm. passed away, and mm-hmm. he was a very wonderful fellow that had a mm-hmm. great deal of talent.
He certainly did.
Was sorely missed by us all.
That's right.
Put on one of the greatest Jinxes, I think. That it
was a book. It was a very, very fine Jinx. My children all enjoyed that one, and I remember all the numbers that they were in.
Yes.
Betsy was in Happy Talk.
Yes.
And my other two were in I Whistle a Happy Tune.
Yeah, Happy Talk.
You're right. There were, you know, I remember all the numbers from that one.
Yes.
And some skits in it that were funny, too.
Yes, it was fun. But as you say, with the time change in schools and the
mm-hmm.
little lack of kids there for a while, things mm-hmm. just kind of slowed down. What at White Lake, getting to the Jinx also, but a little expanding, what are some of the most notable characters that you remember from White Lake during your period here?
Notable characters.
Somebody famous that you saw here or somebody that's just... was a character, Mr. Schmidt, or so, you know, just somebody that, people that you remember here. Of course, your husband, Tom, was probably one of the greatest characters.
Well, yes, right. Yes, well, we'll start with him. John Reitz. Do you know this name? Played the trumpet.
He used to play it at the
yes,
lake.
Yes, he played the play on the lake, and we were privileged to meet him. He was staying over at Ina Diamond's one night. Oh, this is a long time ago again. But he was over there and we had not met. And Ina said, come over and meet John. And she was telling us that this is what he did. Tom looked at him and says, "You want to play tonight?" And John said, "Well, sure." So we brought him over and put him in the big green boat, took him out in the lake, and he did a little concert that night. And that was kind of fun. And everybody that heard him, of course, that knew him, recognized it and remembered, "Ah, there's John out there with his trumpet again." That was fun.
Well, that was
fun too. That is. Hey, Joe, I don't know about characters. The place is full of characters.